Simonson, and he's going to show you some exciting stuff over here.
Okay.
Who is Tait?
So, like Pirjo said, Tait Simonson. I teach at Central Valley, K through 12. This is year 6 for me over there. It's been really exciting. I went starting it right out of grad school. It was a really random circumstance, and I found out that it was Central Valley, and it's been great. Went to graduate school at PNCA out in Portland, Oregon, and undergrad at Vermillion, South Dakota, my BFA. My work in this show is kind of a little bit of an oddity for me. It was something that I just kind of started making one day, just kind of because I felt like it, and it was this piece right here is the original. It's clay, I bisqued it, and then after I made it, I was like, man, I really like this. So I was like, I think I should make more of them, and no real clear plan, and so I decided to make this rubber silicone mold. I can take it apart, but I left one that I just recently poured. I started doing this kind of odd process where it's in a couple parts. So a few of these, there's maybe half a dozen or so, are resin and concrete. So this one is a pretty good example of that. It's partly resin, and right now it's just concrete, and then there's expansion foam in there to create the void so that I can pour resin in and fill it. This one is an example of that. It's resin and concrete, but this one I just kind of did them both at the same time. I thought I would just see what happened. So with this work, it's just been a lot of fun. It's a lot of experimentation with materials and seeing how they interact. I've done stuff with resin, but not so much concrete, but it just feels like kind of a grittier clay to me, really. So, love working with clay, wood, metal, and all of that. The more different materials I can play with and experiment in, the better for me. So, really, it's just a lot of that kind of stuff. And when these two asked if I wanted to do it, I was like, the only stuff I've got that we could put in the show is a bunch of skulls. So, if you want to do it, you're okay with it, I'll go for it. I can make more, so we can put more in there. Every single skull that I made, I tried to do something different with it. So none were the same, and just kept going from there.
Hey,
yep.
Speak a little bit about their names.
Oh, okay. So the names are really weird, or kind of strange, but like, I don't know. I just started, I think it was at summer camp. I brought a few because I had made them, and some kid asked me what his name was, and on the spot, I just was like, you know, and the best thing I could think of is I'm a very avid reader, love reading fiction and stuff like that. So I pulled names from that. Usually with most books and fiction books like that, the authors are picking like these really diverse, kind of unusual names that aren't typical names. So then I started pulling from that. I have a pretty big bank of names that I could pull from. So one couple nights ago, earlier this week, I sat down and I was on the phone with my brother, who also has his own artistic pursuits, and I just shared a document with him so he could look at all of them, and I just started talking, kind of just rambled at him while we were on the phone, and he just occasionally was like, yeah, that sounds okay, Tait, and then we did that, and then I just kind of tried to price him out too, but all the names are book characters, and I thought that would be kind of interesting, just because of the uniqueness of the names, and then also just something that's probably a big part of my life. Told me what color my brain was, and it's kind of interesting. I'm not sure. Mostly, I think it's because of my preference with the cold weather.
Wonderful. Chris, and just kind of share what we're doing. And yeah, I think while I'm in that practice, most of my thoughts just revolve around, it's kind of like everything exists as an idea first. And I kind of spin off that, like, okay, well, then where do ideas come from? I don't know, experiences? Okay, well, then what's it like to just experience making something? And then just kind of going with that. And these two, like, I always feel like I need to put a period at the end of something I'm making. And this time I didn't have to. And that was really kind of nerve-wracking for me, but really nice to have their support in this practice. And I really like what came up. So, yeah, thank you to everybody.
Does anybody have any questions to ask about anything?
Matt, what's the process with this? I mean, how is it all, I didn't read very closely, is it watercolor? No, it's oil.
It's a pretty specific mixture of black ink, so the black can be kind of a warm, soft color tone, right? Because sometimes ink tends to really shine up and be hard and kind of pushes you back. So I was looking for a color, like a color black that let me go in, and then using watercolor, and everything is wet at the same time. So using watercolor, which pushes away the ink also, just, I can't explain the techniques, but it's pushing away the ink with watercolor and water and letting it rest. And some of it is in my control, and a lot of it is out for us to say. Some of it has my intention, because my intention to get these watercolor doors in black and ink and color. Other than that, it's not in my control. And what I like is that it's that idea, right? Like, where does, like, I keep having to look at that and say, that looks like a skull, that looks like a bird head, that looks like a buffalo. But I like that part of my brain that's constantly trying to find associations and lock into finding, like, what it is, and it's never gonna get there. And that can be really unnerving sometimes. I think even like experiencing COVID these times, like, when is it gonna end? What are we gonna do? What's next? Just being kind of directionless can be really uncomfortable. But it also, if you just do the process in my studio, I'm just there in that moment. Then it kind of brings it all back to, okay, it's, I don't have to be so caught up in what the point is at the end of it. So I hope that kind of explains the process.
Yeah.
Most of it is putting on music, getting home, putting incense on, sitting down. It's a whole ritual thing before I can dive in. There's that too.
These works go really well together. Did you and Pirjo look at each other's things? You know, as you were deciding your wall situation, or even as you were creating them, know what he's doing.
I think it was all about discussion too, but I don't know. We just have very good communication for every reason, but I don't know. We just came here, and first we were thinking, shall we put my pieces on that side? You know, somehow the Tait pieces kind of settled their place. And then we started to put these paintings around the installations of the skulls. And then, you know, it was, we were moving them around in the end. And then we, I don't know, they just kind of started.
They just went together.
They
yeah.
just
you didn't
kind of,
plan anything.
We
no.
didn't
you
plan
kind of
it.
Work,
no,
work
we
together.
Didn't plan that way anything. It has a little bit moodiness, I would say. Kind of moody.
Yeah.
But some people have asked, that corner over there, those kind of like photo pieces, because they are a little bit different. And we were trying to put them together with these guys, and they just didn't work out. But I still wanted to put those over there, because they are actually, with me and my husband, my husband was saying that he found those photo containers where you can take old-fashioned photo things, he said that he found them 20 years ago from University of Washington trash. And I said, no, I found them from the States. So there is kind of confusion, but they've been at my studio about 20 years. You know, they was, and I really haven't had ever any idea what to do with them. I kind of always was thinking. And actually, Matt came to my studio and we were looking at them and I was like, yeah, they are there. And I was like, they're kind of cool object itself. And then I, you know, in some way in the middle of the night, you awake and you start to think about, photos, paintings. What is the difference between photos and paintings? And then they kind of started to, okay, it's kind of like, two of those frames actually still have the photo paper inside. So I use those photo papers and because, you know, I've kind of been playing quite some time around that idea of my pieces looking like photos, but they are not photos because if you take a photo, you've been there. But if you make a painting, you haven't been there, but you've been there in your mind, kind of. So that's kind of like, you know, kind of what I'm thinking about, difference between photos. Sometimes I'm talking about very painterly photographs. But then, how about, can painters be photographs? Because, you know, different ideas, kind of concept. So anyway, so I finally, I think I'm happy to use those guys and get them out from my studio. And so it's kind of like that, you know, somebody probably a long time ago take a photo out of that, maybe not, and it didn't work out, and I just made the photo or painting or whatever it is. Anyway, so that's that corner over there, and then these others, kind of that blue is blue, I think. I kind of started to think about my paintings at one point. What is common with this series of pieces? And I was like, oh, they all have blue. I've been actually last about, maybe, since I moved here, I found a beautiful combination of ultramarine blue and raw ochre. And then I'm hitting there some other blues every now and then. Trying some other colors every now and then, but my palette is very limited. So, so you can see very limited palette. And then I use oil very much like watercolor. We were talking about that. So I use the light coming from the paper. Those who paint a lot, Brian, you know, usually it is that oil paints. You start with middle ground and then you build up with the light, white. But these are kind of like I'm trying to, because watercolor is so beautiful because it does something for you. It just kind of create possibilities. But then oil tries to control you too much. But then anyway, so that's kind of long talk. Nobody asked any questions, but I did talk. End up talking. But you can ask questions too. But anyway, I was so happy to have this show with you guys, and I hope we continue our discussion and keep having a community. We hope to have a community over here with artists and artist lovers and love of art too. You don't have to love us. You can only love your art. I kind of say it. I always can say it's my English as a second language. I can love art. You don't have to love us. Any other questions?
That is interesting, Odomero, when you asked if we worked, how we work together.
Yes, because it goes together.
Yep. This is how we work together.
It just happened.
It's through discussion. We didn't. I visited Pirjo's studio once, but I wasn't there to try to. At that time, I wasn't there thinking about the show. It was just a studio visit. But I think through just the three of us talking to each other, most of them, this is what happens. And it does in a really unexpected way. I think, God, this works. And I can't figure it out. It's cool. I mean, there's I know that I have things that I think about, you know, how this works with, like, asking questions, or, like, Tait's, like, these skull pieces, to me, like, yeah, they represent death, right? Something that we have, okay, I'll only speak for myself, I have no idea what that experience is going to be. I doubt if anybody else really, you know, knows. It's something that people think about, and you know, and I think about, like, you know, these images too. Like, what are the things we know, and what are the things that we just wonder about all the time? So even these questions, right? Yeah, these conversations to each other, I think, just create something that wasn't. That makes sense.
You did a whole bunch of black crows at one time, didn't you? It just seems to me that you had something on the wall someplace that was black crow. That is not you?
I know. I used to work very representationally and shifted away, so I'm trying to think if I ever made black crows. I can't honestly tell you.
Okay.
Interesting,
because to me a black crow is death coming.
Sure.
You know, and
yeah.
I just thought, wow. Ask.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Well, thank you all. Any other questions? Any comments? Weird stuff.